Welcome to the Jill on Money Call of the Week. If you would like to ask a financial question or a career question or a retirement question or anything else on your mind, we'd love to hear from you. All you have to do, send us an email, askjill@jillonmoney.com. Askjill@jillonmoney.com, or you can always get to us from the website, jillonmoney.com, and just click on the Contact Us button. Today, we've got Leith from North Carolina. What can I do for you?
So, listen, recently retired, gave my wife and I an opportunity to take a look at our savings and our IRAs and our 401s and everything and combine them and more or less have a better view of what we have now in terms of our retirement savings.
Okay.
So my question to you is, our savings are made up of IRAs, 401s, some cash, some real estate, and that type of thing. But, I'm not an expert in finance. So my concern is, how do I know, or what are some flashpoints that I should be aware of to say, hey, wait a minute, are we in good shape in case we have another economic downturn? I just want to be prepared and not caught off, not knowing what to do when I start to see the warning signs.
You know, I think that's a great question. Let me go back first and do the more mundane stuff, which is you and your life. So you are retired. How old are you?
I am 67.
And your wife is how old?
She is 66.
And is she also retired?
Yes.
Okay. If you look at your total income from Social Security, pensions, any real estate income, what is the income that is coming in every year now?
Well, of course, that depends, but probably somewhere around $100,000, maybe.
Great. And does that $100,000 cover your basic needs or even your desired needs?
It does.
Okay, so you're good. So the income you're generating is good. Are you in that $100,000, are you including money that's coming out of your investment accounts or just money from pensions, Social Security, or real estate income?
It would be really a combination of all.
Okay. So if I had to say, what is the income that is coming almost automatically? So Social Security and pensions, what would that number be?
That would probably be 75% of it.
Oh, okay. So great. So Social Security and pension. And so you need another $25,000 from your total savings / retirement savings to generate the money you need on an ongoing basis, right?
I would say that's a fair statement.
Great. Now, tell me how much money right now you have in just retirement assets, meaning your IRAs and your 401ks.
I would say probably close to $2 million.
Okay. And savings, cash, meaning money that's already been taxed that's set aside.
Yeah, probably another one.
Okay. And real estate, you own your home now?
Yes, I do.
Okay. No mortgage?
No mortgage.
Great. Let me just say this. If I could give you like one of those weird checklists and from like a doctor, and I would say, if you gave me this as a doctor, I would say you are in stunning health. You have nothing to worry about. Okay?
Well, yeah.
You want to worry? I'll let you worry. Don't worry.
No, I don't want to worry, but I want to be smart. I don't want to be caught not knowing
you.
Something.
I got you. But here's one of the reasons why we go through this sort of exercise. Because you got $3 million, right? Mm-hmm. If you were the most risk-averse person in the world, if you said, I hate risk, I never want to, I could just have maybe 20% in the stock market. That's it. And everything else, I really want to batten down the hatches. I want to be safe. You would still be able to pull $50,000, $60,000 out of this account every year, pay some taxes due on the pre-tax stuff, and have the money you need to support yourself. The reason why that's important to know is you're going to ask me a question now about how to prepare for bad things happening. And what I can tell you is the easiest thing to do to prepare for bad things happening is to save a boatload of money. And you've done that already. So that is essentially the hardest work. And it's the biggest challenge that when people call in here, I have to say to them, well, you know what? You actually haven't done such a good job. You have done an amazing job. So the reason why this is so important is that you've put away the money that you need, more than you need. the money that you need to generate income-wise is really such a low number relative to the total assets that you've saved that you don't really even have to take on a lot of risk.
You know, I listen to a lot of different people about finances and read things, and one of the things I'm hearing is somebody saying, you know, don't have a lot of cash in banks right now, have it in the market. You have cash in banks in these, you know, not making any money. What should you do with your cash that you have in savings accounts in banks that
okay.
really is not doing anything?
So first of all, I think that people who are saying, oh, don't have cash on hand are idiots. Is that a nice way of saying it? Because you've got to have enough cash on hand to weather a downturn. So this gets into your question, which is, you know, you've got cash on hand. What should you do with it? Well, one way to weather a downturn is to make sure that you've got some money in cash. So let's talk about what you would need to feel comfortable. Pretend it is, let's just say you retired and it's the end of 2007. You've entered 2008 with the exact same scenario you just laid out to me. And at the beginning of 2008, I will tell you that pretty much all these knuckleheads that worked at big investment houses were saying the same thing. They were saying, don't have cash on hand, the market's doing well, buy the dips, all those things, because no one really quite understood the magnitude of what was going to lie ahead of them. That said, the best defense against an economic downturn is to have basically no debt. You know, you had your mortgage still, it wouldn't be a big deal, but you don't have debt. And to have 2 years of expenses sitting in a safe place, which for you, you know, you don't even, you get income, but let's say you said, I'm going to keep 200 grand in cash and you want to maximize that cash. You want to have some laddered CDs. You want to have some short-term government bond funds just so you have a little bit of extra juice as opposed to a rotten money market or savings account rate. Fine. But beyond that, you don't need more. And then when you really want to prepare for something going badly, you have a well-diversified portfolio. What you are now asking me is, well, how can I prepare for an economic downturn but also take advantage of the market continuing to rise? And the answer is you can't have it both ways. You know that because every investor knows that. So what is the portfolio that's going to prepare you for if something bad were to happen in the future, but also allow you to participate? And that is pretty much of a classic balanced portfolio. So if you looked at your retirement assets and you said, well, I've got half of the stuff that's mostly in risky assets and half of it in less risky assets like bonds or at least having, you know, it doesn't have to be the most boring bond, but it could be a types, various bond types. That is sort of splitting the difference. But you can't have it both ways. And I don't think you need to. The part about your situation that's amazing to me is that, in essence, you don't actually need to grow your money. Your money will last you for the rest of your life. I know you don't want to give it away, but you have to ask yourself this question. Let me ask you, what would make you more upset? If I looked at the next year and I said, let's say the next 3 years before you turn 70, in the next 3 years, you can either fully participate in the market's rise or you would have to fully participate in the market falling apart. Which is more appealing to you?
Well, of course, if the market rises, right?
Oh, see, that's the fascinating thing. Maybe. Let's say that I said...
Well, but let me amend my answer to you.
Okay.
Well, my position has been always about pace and balance.
Right.
So I feel like our portfolio is balanced. I mean, we have domestic stocks, we have bonds, but we're very conservative.
Okay.
So I can be completely happy with not a lot of growth every year, but a moderate amount of growth, as long as it's, you know, pretty consistent year in and year out.
Mm-hmm. But let me, I guess what I'm wondering from my perspective is, why are you so focused on the growth part since you are a balanced investor? You started the call with, like, how can I prepare for an economic downturn? And I would say to you,
right,
you know, it's pretty easy. The way you prepare for it is to have some cash on hand and to make sure that you're not asking too much of your portfolio's performance on the downside. So if the market were down by 25% next year because we're in a recession, Would you care that your $3 million turned into $2.5 million? Or would you be more concerned with making sure that that $3 million stays $3 million? In other words, as you get older and you need to rely on your assets to generate income, most people would say, I'm much more afraid of losing money than concerned about making money on the way up. And that's what I'm trying to figure out from you. Are you more concerned about losing something if the market were to turn south, or are you more concerned with not missing out on the way up?
I guess I'm more concerned with the first part.
Yeah, of course you are, because you're a human being, and that's the smart way to be. So yeah. What I need you to try to do, which is so hard, is I need you to try to drown out the little devil that's sitting on the side of sitting on your shoulder and saying to you, don't miss out on the top, don't miss out on this, don't miss, because of course you're going to miss out on it. You are not right. The type of person who needs to actually capture so much of the upside. Frankly, if the market is up 10% this year and you're only up 4%, it doesn't matter. You're fine. You're in amazing shape. You have done the hard work. You've saved the money. So now, right. As opposed to every other knucklehead out there that really has to invest to beat inflation, and you don't have to worry. You are in a great place. So
okay.
Just try to remember that. Say, every time the market goes up, or the fact that I have too much money in cash, I call that, it's called sleep at night money. If you're really wanting to have a portfolio that is bulletproof against a downturn, you've done it. The way to do it is actually to save your whole life and then not to risk too much as you get older.
Right, right. Well, no, I understand that 100%.
And I think you're in good shape.
Well, what I wanted to get from this call was a level of assurance and, I guess, confidence in what we're doing is the right thing.
Yes.
To be doing. It sounds like we are.
Yeah, you are. And you've done a tremendous job. You've saved the money you need. Okay, that's the call of the week. We drop new episodes of Jill on Money every Tuesday and Thursday, and you can download the show anywhere that you get your podcasts, Apple, Google Play, Radio.com, Stitcher, wherever. If you have a financial question, just give us a holler. Send an email to askjill@jillonmoney.com or go to the website, jillonmoney.com. You can click the Contact Us button right there. Oh, by the way, while you're there, sign up for our free newsletter. It's free. Why not? Our music is composed by Joel Goodman. Mark Talercio is our executive producer. We're distributed by Cadence 13. See you next week.